Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Continuing with our journey through Kitab Salah of Umdat al-Fiqh, lil Imam al-Muqdam al-Maqdasi rahimullah ta'ala. Revision questions. If you close your books, inshallah, just quickly, if you have them. The Imam, he mentioned that in the tashahud, or when you sit in the Salah, wherever it be, you sit muftarishan. What does muftarishan mean? What was his description of muftarishan? Iftirash. We described it. It means, yeah. No, this is something else. Iftirash.
To sit upon your life.
Very good. Jazakallahu khairan. I thought you'd give me a command of some sort. Iftirash is to have your right foot up and to be sitting on your left foot, okay? Flattened out. That's iftirash. The Imam, he says, he taught us in the tashahud that we say attahiyatu lillah. What does it mean when you say attahiyatu lillah? What's the meaning of that? Attahiyatu lillah. Yes, brother. Close, okay? All magnification and glorification belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. Every form of ta'zeem, every form of tasbih belongs in its perfect manner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib. He also taught us that we say the tashahud when we say Allahumma salli Muhammad wa la ali Muhammad. What does the word al Muhammad mean? When you're saying the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was the secondary meaning of that? And the ummah, all of those who followed the way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We were taught innaka hamidun majid also. What does the word hamid mean? When referring to Allah, we're praising Allah, innaka hamidun majid. What is hamid? That's one of its meanings. So one of its meanings is that mahmud, the one who is worthy of all praise. Another of its meanings, that Allah is Hamid, right? Hamid means Hamid wal Mahmud. Hamid, the one who gives praise for that which is worthy, or the person who is worthy of praise. And Mahmud, meaning that Allah is praised for His perfect attributes, etc. What are the four things that the Imam, he taught us to seek refuge in Allah from in the tashahud? Before, yeah. The grave, the fire, Jahannam, Masih al-Dajjal, and what was the fourth one? And the trials of life and death. Jazakallahu khairan. So that's where we stopped, okay, in the last session, before last week, because last week was a break. The Imam, he continues to say, rahimullah ta'ala, ثُمَّ يُسَلِّمُ عَنْ يَمِينِهِ. Then the person gives the salam on his right, assalamu alaykum, wa rahmatullahi wa an yasarihi kadhalik. Okay? The person, when he's praying, he makes the salim to his right and to his left, saying, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah on his right and his left. When you give this taslim, who are you giving the salam to? Who are you saying assalamu alaykum to? Yes. A bit louder, please. Very good. To the angels, right? You're giving salam to the angels and to those who are praying with you. Anybody who's praying with you, you give salam to them. And also you are conveying salam to the angels who are there present with you, writing down your deeds. Jazakallahu khairan. Sometimes, when you give this taslim, you can add something to it. As narrated by Wa'il ibn Hujr, and collected by Abu Dawood, he said, "Salaytu ma'an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fakana yusallimu an yaminihi assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu wa an shimalihi assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah." What's the extra here? That the Wa'il ibn Hujr, as narrated by Abu Dawood, he said, "I prayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said to his right, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And he said to his left, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah." So at times you can make the increase, okay, of wa barakatuhu. But this is not something which is recommended to do all of the time. You can do it at times. The majority, they hold that the second taslim, it's sunnah. The second taslim is sunnah. The first is a rukn, but the second is sunnah. But Imam Ahmed and some of the Maliki scholars, they said no, the second taslim is wajib. It's something which should be done. And if you're leading the salah as the imam, okay, then you should do it. You shouldn't leave it off. Why? Why am I saying that? Okay, there's an opinion out there that it's sunnah. But if you're the imam, you should still enact the second taslim, regardless of whether it's you hold it as sunnah or wajib.
If there's people following, hold it as wajib.
Exactly, exactly. Okay? Because there are people behind you who may hold it as wajib. So to avoid any differences of opinion, to avoid any differing of the hearts, especially that it's not going to affect your salah, it's only going to increase you in reward, then do so, okay? Come out of the difference of opinion wherever you are able to do so. So the imam, he says, وَإِن كَانَتِ الصَّلَاةِ أَكْثَرْ مِنْ رَكْعَتَيْنِ نَحَدَى بَعْدَ التَّشَهُدِ الْأَوَّلِ كَنُهُودِهِ مِنَ السُّجُودِ. If the prayer is more than two rak'ah, then he gets up, right, for the third and the fourth rak'ah after the tashahud, the first tashahud, like he gets up from the sujood. How does he get up from the sujood, as we were taught by the imam? What is the way to get up from the sujood for the second rak'ah? Without pausing, okay, jalsatul istirah, but that wouldn't fit into our thing anyway, because this is tashahud, you're already sitting anyway. And the second thing you were saying? Okay, so without pausing, because that element of pausing was a discussion after the sajda, right? But this is, you've sat already for the tashahud, so you wouldn't need to pause. What he's referring to here is that you get up without using your hands, okay? And you get up with your hands coming up first, okay? That's what he means to say. You get up without using your hands to get yourself up. Like we said, that the Prophet ﷺ, when he would go down to make sujood, he would go down on the knees first, and when he would get up hands first, okay? This is what the imam means, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. طيب, the imam, he says, ثُمَّ يُسَلِّي رَكَعَتَيْنَ لَا يَقْرَى فِيهِمَا بَعْدَ الْفَاتِحَ شَيْئًا. And then he prays in the second two rak'ah, or the third rak'ah if it's Maghrib, another rak'ah, and he doesn't pray anything after Surah Al-Fatiha. Okay? So if it's your third rak'ah or your fourth rak'ah, after Surah Al-Fatiha, you don't pray anything. But there is a narration in Sahih Muslim of Abi Sa'id Al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, where he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would pray in the third rak'ah and the fourth rak'ah of Dhuhr and Asr, some ayat from the Qur'an after Surah Al-Fatiha. So based on this narration, some of the ulama, such as Sheikh Hamad Al-Hamad in his explanation of Zad Al-Mustaqni', they said that it's good once in a while to keep this sunnah and to do so. So after you've prayed in the fard, the third rak'ah or the fourth rak'ah or both of them, then it's good once in a while to add something to Surah Al-Fatiha. Okay, even though the imam and the majority, they say no. فَإِذَا جَلَسَ لِتَشَهُدِ الْأَخِيرِ تَوَرَّكْ. If you sit for the last tashahud, you make tawarruk. And then he's going to give an explanation of what that is. فَنَصَبَ رِجْلَهُ الْيُمْنَى وَفَرَشَ الْيُسْرَى. So what you do, like the iftirash, you put your right foot up and you lay down your left leg. But the difference is, وَأَخْرَجَهَا عَنْ يَمِينِهِ. The difference between the iftirash and the tawarruk is that tawarruk, your left leg, you're going to bring the foot out from underneath you, from underneath your right. Okay, so your right is there, your left foot is going to come out from underneath you. From underneath. Does anybody know how to do it? Tawarruk. Could you show it, bro? Come to the middle if you don't mind, please. Jazakallahu khair. Yeah, so they can see. Ahsant. This is tawarruk, right? This is one of the sifas. So his foot is coming out from underneath his right, okay? Another way you can do that, I can't see what, how is his back foot? Is it up? Okay. Another way you can do it is the same way, but you can have the right foot the same as the left, meaning like so, right? Flat, yeah, flat. That's the second way. A third way you can do it is to bring the foot which is underneath, from in between your shin, the back of your calf. Okay? So the foot will be under, between the calf. So that foot that you're sitting on will be there, exactly. That's the third way, right? So the second way, we said both feet would be like that. The third way is that the foot will come out from underneath, underneath the thigh, between the thigh and the calf. Between the thigh and the calf. I'll send a picture of this on the group, inshallah, later on. So this is tawarruk. And the Imam, he says, وَلَا يَتَوَرَّكْ إِلَّا فِي صَلَاةٍ فِيهَا تَشَهُدَانْ فِي الْأَخِيرِ مِنْهَا مِنْهُمَا. Okay, so you don't make this tawarruk except in the prayer which has two tashahud, and you do it in the last of them. Okay, so in Fajr you don't do it, okay, because it's not two tashahud. You do it any prayer which has two tashahud, and in the last of the tashahud, tashahud al-akhir. The Imam, he says, فَإِذَا سَلَّمَا إِسْتَغْفَرَ ثَلَاثًا. And then when you make the taslim, you seek after that forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala three times. So why would you seek forgiveness after Allah's, from Allah azza wa jal? You've just done a good deed, one of the most beloved deeds to Allah azza wa jal, one of the greatest deeds you can do in terms of reward. So why are you now seeking forgiveness? What's the link here? Normally you seek forgiveness from Allah azza wa jal when you've done something wrong, when you've made a mistake, right? But here you're seeking istighfar from Allah azza wa jal after doing a great, amazing deed. For any deficiencies in the salah. And for sure there will be deficiencies in your salah. Two ways to look at it. It's like the brother said, for example, you may have a deficiency. Maybe you had a lapse of concentration. Maybe your mind went somewhere else, right? Maybe you forgot to do a particular sunnah, which you're not going to be sinful for, but you're losing reward for. Maybe you actually made a bigger mistake. But the reality of the situation is, think about who you are praying to. You're praying to Allah Azza wa Jal, the Majesty and the Lord of all Lords, the King of all Kings, the one who owns everything in creation. So when you think about how a poor person, when he goes in front of a king and he presents to him a gift, how does that poor person feel? The poor person realizes within his soul that what I'm giving you doesn't befit your Majesty. Likewise, when you're praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and any good deed that you do, you feel happy and you feel elated that you've had the opportunity to do it, but you always feel inside of you this taqseer, this shortcoming. That Allah azza wa jal, I worshipped you, but I didn't worship you to the ability and in the correct way that I should have done so. That is deserving and befitting to you. So this is why the ulama say, the wisdom behind making istighfar after the salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The Imam, he says, after you seek forgiveness from Allah three times, you say, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dha jalali wal ikram. Okay, and this comes in Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Thawban, where he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, idha kana idha sarafa an-nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam min salatihi istaghfara thalathan wa qala Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dha jalali wal ikram. Okay, in the hadith of Thawban in Sahih Muslim, he said that the Prophet ﷺ, when he would finish his prayer, he would seek forgiveness from Allah three times, and then he would make this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma anta as-salam. Oh Allah, you as-salam. What does it mean that Allah is as-salam? Allahumma anta as-salam. Allahumma anta as-salam here means, oh Allah, you are free. Anta salim, you are free from any imperfections or shortcomings. This is what it means when you say anta salam, okay? Wa minka salam, and from you is salam, is what the brother just mentioned. That from you is the source of peace and security. Okay, so we seek security and we seek peace from you. Tabarakta ya dha jalali wal ikram. Blessed are you, O Allah, the one who is completely rich and the one who is forever bestowing his favors upon his slaves. Sheikh Abdul Aziz al-Rajihi, he says, discussing the adhkar which we normally do after the salah, in his explanation of this book, Sheikh Abdul Aziz al-Rajihi, he said it's of five different ways. Okay, after this, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, we make other adhkar, don't we? He said the first of them is that you say, as mentioned in Sahih Muslim, you say Subhanallah 33 times. You say Alhamdulillah 33 times. You say Allahu Akbar 33 times, and what do you say to make it 100? La ilaha illallah. Okay, this is the first of them. The second of them, as mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim by the narration of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, is that you say Subhanallah 33 times. You say Alhamdulillah 33 times, and you say Allahu Akbar 33 times. Right? So the difference was La ilaha illallah is left out. Okay, so it's 99 instead of 100. The third of these narrations is the narration in Bukhari of Ali radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet ﷺ taught him in Fatima to say 33 times Allahu Akbar, sorry, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah 33 times, and Allahu Akbar 34 times, right? The fourth of these ways, as mentioned by the hadith of Umar, collected by Imam Nisa'i, where the Prophet ﷺ taught to say Subhanallah 25 times, Alhamdulillah 25 times, Allahu Akbar 25 times, and La ilaha illallah 25 times. The fifth of them is to say, as mentioned in Bukhari, narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, say Subhanallah 10 times, Alhamdulillah 10 times, and La ilaha illallah 10 times. Okay? And this was mentioned by Shaykh Abdulaziz al-Rajihi, and it's also mentioned by other scholars. Tayyib, with that, we come to the end of the part of the salah where the Imam, he's finished with describing how to do the prayer. He's finished now the description of the prayer. Now he's going to start something which is extremely important. Bab arkana salah wa wajibatuha. The chapter wherein he's going to mention the arkan, the rukun of the prayers, and what is wajib in the prayer. Why do you think we need to know what is a rukun and what is wajib in the prayer? Why will this help us? Exactly. Because if we miss a rukun, something's going to take place. There's going to be a consequence. If we miss a wajib, there's going to be a consequence. And we need to know these things for the next chapter, which is sajood as-sahw. How to make the prostration of forgetfulness, and when to make the prostration of forgetfulness. So firstly, the rukun and the wajib. What is the difference between the rukun and the wajib? We mentioned this before. A rukun is a pillar, right? Wajib is an obligation. What are one of the differences between the rukun and the wajib? Good. So the brother is saying, for example, the rukun, whether you leave it out intentionally or unintentionally, your salah is going to be invalid due to that. The only time a rukun can be left out is due to ajz. If somebody is ajz and unable to perform that rukun, like standing is a rukun in the salah, but the person has a disability, can't stand, so that rukun is taken away from him. Whereas the wajib, if you leave it intentionally, it will invalidate your salah. But if you leave it unintentionally, you can correct that by doing the sujood as-sahw. Okay? So this is different to the rukun. So the Imam, he says that the first of the arkan is al-qiyam ma'al qudra, that you stand if you have the ability to do so. Because Allah Azza wa Jal says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ, and stand for Allah in worship and in obedience. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Imran ibn Hussein in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, صَلِّ قَائِمًا, stand in the prayer, فَإِن لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ فَقَائِدًا, and if you cannot, then sitting down, فَإِن لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ, and if you are unable to even sit down, فَعَلَى جَمْ. So the Prophet ﷺ commanded that we pray standing. طيب, if the Imam, مسألة, if the Imam, he prays sitting down, right, then you should also pray sitting down. Because of the hadith which we've taken many times, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِي, verily the Imam has been made to be followed. Okay? And at the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِذَا صَلَّ جَالِسًا فَصَلُّ جُلُوسًا أَجْمَعًا. So if he prays sitting down, so then all of you should pray sitting down. But if the Imam knows that he has a problem and he's going to pray sitting down, it's better for him to bring somebody else who can perform the prayer standing. Why? Because performing the prayer standing is more complete, okay, in the sense of performing a prayer. And number two, it takes you out from the difference of opinion amongst the ulama of what you should do behind the imam who's praying sitting down. Should you pray standing or should you pray sitting? Tayyib? So, how is this standing in the salah? What if somebody's standing and he's bowing down a little bit, or his head is bowing like so? Does this affect his standing? Somebody's standing in the salah, but he's, you know, his back is not straight, or his head is not upright, it's bowing down for some reason. The ulama, they said this doesn't affect the salah in the sense that his standing will still be valid, but it takes away from the completion and the beauty of the prayer. Okay? So they say the standing should be to the extent that your arms, right, they don't touch your knees. Your standing should be to the extent that you're not low enough that your hands will easily touch your knees, okay? Unless you have extra long arms, then that's a separate issue altogether. What if a person, he's standing in the salah, and you've seen this many a time, that it's Qiyam al-Layl, for example, it's a long salah, and the person starts moving his feet around. You know, he lifts up one leg to give it a quick rest and shake, or he scratches his foot with one of his feet. So he's off one of his legs for a few moments. Does that affect the salah? Because he's not standing on 2 feet now, right? You get the mas'ala. So the person, he's tired, he's lifted his leg up to allow the blood to flow. Or he's scratching his foot with the other foot. So he's standing on one leg. Yeah, please, please.
If he did it for long enough,
mm-hmm. Yeah. This is very good. So you look at the person, and from a distance, if it... to you, he's not, or to a normal person, when the person looks at him, he would think he's not praying, right? Then that will invalidate his salah. Say for example, you know, like the Buddhist monks do. Like when they stand, sometimes they lift the other leg up very high for balance. So if somebody was to do something like that, then you wouldn't really consider him praying. So this would affect his salah. But the ulama, they say in general, it doesn't affect the salah. Why? Because the man is still standing linguistically. He still fits the description of standing. So he's still standing in the prayer, okay? So this doesn't affect the salah, but it's something which is makruh. It's something which is disliked, of course. Because when you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should stand with etiquette. And you stand with khushu and humility. And stand in a way which is befitting your meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You wouldn't do that in front of your boss. You wouldn't do it in front of somebody who has status in the dunya. So why would you then do it in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So we said that the person has to pray standing. What if the person prays sitting down in the nafil? He gets half the reward, okay? What if the person prays sitting down? For example, when will he get the full reward while praying sitting down? If he's not able to stand for some reason, right? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith in Bukhari, إِذَا سَافَرَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ مَرِدَ كُتِبَ لَهُمْ مِنَ الْأَجْرِ مِثْلُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ صَحِيحًا مُقِيمًا. That if a person goes on a journey, right? So now he's unable to perform certain acts of worship because he's on a journey, or he becomes sick, then he gets the same reward as he used to do while he was a resident or whilst he was in good health. So if a person cannot stand due to some sickness, right, then he's still going to get the full and complete reward. It's not a case that he will get half the reward. When else would the person still get the full reward, although he's sitting? We took this, if you remember, from the shurut of the salah. So a person becomes sick, he cannot stand, for example, right? But there's another reason maybe that a person has to sit, though he has full health. If you remember from the conditions of the salah when we were talking about the covering of the awrah. Yeah. So the person, for example, la samhallah, the person, may Allah protect us and all Muslims, is put in prison, for example. And he's forced to be in a state of uncover. So in that situation, if he's with others, then it's better for him to pray sitting down. But if he's alone, then it's better for him to pray standing up. Tayyib. The Imam, he said, what was the first rukn he mentioned for us? He mentioned al-qiyam ma'al-qudra. Then he mentions for us the second rukn, wa takbiratul ihram. Making the takbiratul ihram. What is takbiratul ihram? What do we mean when we say takbiratul ihram? We say Allahu Akbar. Do we mean the raising of the hands, or do we mean the statement? As the statement, right? Not the raising of the hands. The raising of the hands is sunnah. It's recommended. But the rukn is actually the saying Allahu Akbar. And we said that nothing else will be accepted except for the words Allahu Akbar. Except for in some of the scholars, like the madhab of the Hanafi scholars, may Allah have mercy upon them, they said any other word which gives the same meaning, okay, like Allahu Ajal, okay, for example, then they accepted that because they said it has the same meaning. So Takbiratul Ihram, collected by Imam Ahmad, Abi Dawood in Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated, or he said, that miftah salah at-tahur, that the key to the prayer is purification, at-tahur. وَتَحْرِيمُهَا التَّكْبِيرُ وَتَحْلِيلُهَا التَّسْلِيمُ. He said his tahrim is to make the takbir, and his tahleel is to make taslim. So tahrim, takbiratul ihram, why is it called takbiratul ihram? Why is it called the takbir of becoming haram, becoming forbidden? What does it mean? So what you used to be allowed to do in a halal manner now becomes forbidden for you to do. For example, talking and eating and things like this. Okay? وَتَحْلِيلُهَا التَّسْلِيمُ. And to make it halal again is once you make this taslim. So this is تَكْبِيرَةُ الْإِحْرَامِ. The Imam, he says the third one is وَقِرَاءَةُ الْفَاتِحَة. That you pray Surah Al-Fatiha, right? In every rak'ah. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا صَلَىٰ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَىٰ Surah Al-Fatiha. Okay? The Prophet ﷺ said, there is no prayer for the one who does not pray Surah Al-Fatiha. Who is this a rukun for? It's for the Imam, okay? And for the Munfarid, the one who is the Imam and the one who is praying alone. But as for the Ma'mum, we said it's recommended. Okay, it's recommended, highly recommended. But there is that opinion that it's an obligation as well. We touched upon that. But our Imam, he says that it's something which is highly recommended to do wherever you can do so. After that, the Imam, he mentions which pillar now? Which number? The fourth pillar, right? He says ruku. And then he says as the fifth, a raf min ruku. So once you've made the ruku, you have to make raf min ruku, which is that you have to get up from the ruku and stand straight. Okay? Some of the ulama, they hold this to be sunnah, which is, I always used to think when I used to see some people praying, they would get up very quickly from the ruku, stand and straight into salah. So they would just about stand. And many of them, in fact, do not stand. Why was that? Because this is from their madhab, like for example, the Hanafis and the Malikis, they hold this to be sunnah, right? They have the evidence for that. So that's why you find some of them, unfortunately, they don't stand in a manner which gives them tuma'nina, a relaxed manner, which is how it should be in the salah when you move from position to position. Okay? So raf min al-ruku is something which is a rukun according to our imam and many other scholars. The sixth one was sujood ala sab'atil a'dha, and to make sujood upon seven limbs. What are the seven limbs that you should make sujood upon? The forehead, the nose, that's considered as one, right? Two hands, the two knees, atraf al-qadamain, and the tips of your feet. Which way should your feet be facing? The toes? They should be facing the Qibla. Should they be together or separate? We said they should be together, right? Because of the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. Tayyib. Then the Imam, he says, after saying that you should make the sujood upon the seven, he said, wal jalus anhu, that you raise, you sit from the sujood. Sitting from the sujood, yani bayna sajdatain, between the two sujood, is also a rukn, okay? And then he says, as the eighth one, وَطُمَأْنِينَ فِي هَذِهِ الْأَرْكَانِ, that you have tuma'nina in these pillars. Tuma'nina, as we just mentioned, is that you have a sense of tranquility in movement. So you don't bounce from position to position. Okay? Many of the ulama, they said that this tuma'nina, this tranquility, it means that you allow your limbs to fall into their natural place. So when you've gone into ruku, your limbs, they naturally relax in that place. You've given them the opportunity to do so. Others, they said, it's the miqdar, the length of it is for one tasbih. Okay, so Subhana Rabbi al-Azim or Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. That is enough for you for tuma'nina. But it depends on how fast people say that, right? So if we say to somebody Subhana Rabbi al-Azim is enough, that may not be the case because he says it very quickly. So maybe the better thing is to understand that it means that you allow your limbs to relax in that position. Okay? And then you can move on. So this was the eighth, right? Before we move on, We mentioned the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, which is like an umdah. It is the pillar or one of the references for determining the evidences for the arkan up to where we've got to, okay? Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he narrated that one time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came into the masjid and he prayed. And a man came into the masjid and prayed. Then he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said to him, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. He gave salam to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, Wa alayka salam. Then he said, Irja fa innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray, for verily you have not prayed. So the man, he went back, faraja fa salla kama kana salla. So he went back and he prayed like he did the first time round. Then he came again to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said again, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Wa alayka salam, irja fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli. Hatta fa'ala dhalika thalatha marrat. So the man again came, gave salam. The Prophet ﷺ said, go back and pray, for you have not prayed. So this took place three times. Then the man came after the third time. He said, وَالَّذِي بَعْثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ مَا أَحْسِنُوا غَيْرَ هَذَا فَعَلِّمْنِي. He said, by the one who has sent you with the truth, I cannot do better than this, so please teach me. So the Prophet was sending him back, right? Three times, because he said you didn't pray. After the third time, he made this statement. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ فَكَبِّرْ. If you stand in the prayer, so make the takbir, فَكَبِّرْ. ثُمَّ قْرَأْ مَا تَيَسْرَ مَعْكَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Then read what is easy for you to read from the Qur'an. This is referring to Surah Al-Fatiha. ثُمَّ ارْكَعْ. Then make ruku, حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ رَاقِعًا. Then make the ruku until you have tuma'nina. حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ رَاقِعًا. Right? ثُمَّ ارْفَعْ. Then raise. حَتَّى تَعْتَدِلْ. Then raise until you are standing up completely straight. ثُمَّ اسْجُدْ. حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ سَاجِدًا. Then make the sujood until you are in a position of tuma'nina in the sujood. ثُمَّ ارْفَعْ. حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ جَالِسًا. And then raise from the sujood until you are in a position of sitting, which is between the two sajdas, right? بين سجدتين, with tuma'nina. ثُمَّ فَعَلْ ذَلِكَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ كُلِّهَا. And then do that in all of your prayer. So this hadith famously is known as Al-Masih fi Salatihi, the one who did bad in his salah. Okay? So the Prophet sent him back three times, and then after the third time, he taught him what is obligatory or what is a must for you to have a salah. So this is where the ulama took up to now, the arkan for the things that we have mentioned. Why did the Prophet ﷺ wait until three times? Yani, why did he not tell him the first time? Why did he send him back three times? Why do you think? This is one of the methods of the teaching of the Prophet ﷺ. He done it so much so that now the person was so desirous of wanting to know, how should I pray properly? Had he told him the first time, maybe the man would not have paid as much attention. But after three times of doing it wrong, now the sahabi is so desirous, Ya Rasulullah, I've tried my best. Now let me know for sure how I should pray. So he was fully attentive, right? So this is one of the methods that the Prophet ﷺ would use in teaching. The ninth rukn, the Prophet ﷺ, the Imam, he tells us, وَالتَّشَهُدُ الْأَخِيرُ. The tashahud al-akhir, okay? Saying attahiyyatu lillah to the end of it, to when you reach the salah upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The salah upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to our Imam, is not a rukn, okay? So from attahiyyatu lillah to the end of the tashahud, just before a salah upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is a rukn. Then the Imam, he says, wal julus lahu, and sitting for the tashahud al-akhir is also a rukn. That's the 10th rukn. And the 11th rukn is a taslimatul ula, the first taslim. Okay? To make the first taslim is a rukn. The taslim to the right is a rukn. And then the Imam, he says, the last of these arkan is wa tartibuha ala ma dhakarna, is that you do them in order. You do them in order. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu irka'u wasjudu. Okay? In Surah Al-Hajj, O you who believe, make ruku and make sujood. So where's the proof that we should do it in order? Because Allah Azawajal mentioned first to do the ruku and then to do the sujood. And also the Prophet ﷺ said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as you have seen me pray. And the Prophet ﷺ never went out of the order that we know to be. Okay? So we'll stop here. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything which was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any shortcomings and mistakes was from myself and shaitan. If I was going too fast, please go back and refer to the video. And if you have any questions or clarifications on what we've taken today, then feel free to ask. وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا